I recently made a video about Bresenham's line algorithm. However, when we draw line segments using that algorithm, we get perfectly sharp edges. And this results in what's called aliasing. Xiaolin Wu's line algorithm allows us to solve this problem and draws perfectly anti-aliased lines that look nice and smooth around the edges. The difference is very noticeable when our line is in motion, like in this illustration right here. Bresenham lines move very jittery, but Wu lines look nice and smooth. Of course, when we're not zoomed in, these lines look even nicer, but the difference probably doesn't come across well in this video due to YouTube's video compression. Anyway, first, some important things to note. As always, in these videos, we'll use a coordinate system relative to the top left pixel. That means the x-coordinate increases to the right, and the y-coordinate increases downwards. This is quite common when dealing with 2D graphics, which is why we're using it here. Second, we're gonna assume that the pixel coordinates are located at the center of pixels, which I find more intuitive to look at. Our line segment is defined by a start and end point, here x0, y0, and x1, y1. And the horizontal and vertical difference between these points are called delta x and delta y. Finally, the change in y per one step in x is called the slope, or m. It is calculated by dividing delta y by delta x. With all that out of the way, let's examine a line drawn using Wu's algorithm and see if we can't figure out what it's doing. Here I've taken the resulting pixels of the algorithm and overlaid them with a perfect line. Let's zoom in. First, we need to talk about this very first pixel. It and the last pixel are treated as special cases by the algorithm. That means for the time being, please ignore this pixel. Everything I'm about to tell you does not apply to this pixel for now. Okay, so for every step in the x-coordinate, we have two pixels. One is above and one is below the line. Their opacity depends on the vertical distance to the line. This pixel has a distance of 0.4 pixels. Therefore, it's somewhat opaque and somewhat transparent. The pixel below has a distance of 0.6. Makes sense because both distances should add up to one pixel. As it is 0.6, this pixel is slightly less opaque than the previous one, as it is further away. Next over here, we have a distance of 0.8. That's quite far, therefore this pixel is barely visible. And finally, the pixel below, therefore has a distance of 0.2. It's almost fully opaque, because the distance is very small. I think you get the idea. Now let's examine the exact opacity of each pixel. As you can see, the opacity is always 1 minus the distance. Here on the first pixel, we have a distance of 0.4, 1 minus 0.4 is 0.6, and therefore we have an opacity of 60%. This pixel over here has a distance of 0.8, 1 minus 0.8 is 0.2, meaning the pixel has an opacity of 20%. Another way to look at it is that the opacity is always the distance of the pixel above or below. From all these observations, we now know some important facts about the algorithm. First, we know that we have to place a pixel directly above and below our line along its entire length. Second, we need to find the vertical distance for each pixel on the line. And finally, we use these distances to calculate their opacities. Now we're ready to actually write some code. I'm going to be writing the sample code in Python again, simply because I think its syntax is nice and readable for these examples. Of course, you can use any language that you're actually working with. To begin writing the algorithm, we first need to plot points along our line. That looks something like this. If we zoom in, we can see that for each step we move 1 pixel on the x-axis and m pixels on the y-axis. Let's write a simple loop that does just that. First, we define our drawLine function. Its parameters are just our start and end points. What's nice about this algorithm is that the points can be non-integers. Therefore, we are able to draw lines at subpixel values. Anyway, let's continue and calculate delta x, delta y, and m. And I'll also add a little condition to avoid a division by zero. Then we need to loop through the amount of horizontal pixels we have, and at each iteration we store the x and y coordinate of our plotted points. For every step we move 1 pixel on the x-axis and m pixels on the y-axis. And here's what we get so far. Each yellow point represents our x and y coordinate at every iteration. Now remember, our first step is to place a pixel above and below each plotted point. This is quite simple. Let's turn our coordinates to integers, and then place pixels at these coordinates. Here's the result we get. Notice how all pixels are right above our line. That's exactly what we wanted. By the way, our putPixel function has three parameters. These are the x and y coordinate, followed by an alpha value or opacity between 0 and 1. Of course, this function is just an abstraction for our purposes. You can place pixels in whichever way is most efficient in your language of choice. Moving on, we also wanted to place pixels below each plotted point. To achieve this, we simply place another pixel at each iteration, but increment its y-coordinate by 1. And there we go. Now we have a pixel above and below each plotted point on our line. Next, we need to calculate the vertical distance from our top pixel to the line. As it turns out, this is really, really easy. Let's say the pixel over here is at y-coordinate 3, and that means the pixel below is at y-coordinate 4. Our plotted point is almost halfway between these two, so let's assume it's at y-coordinate 3.4. The distance to the top pixel is therefore 0.4. Note that it'll always be the fractional part of our plotted y-coordinate. And the other pixel's distance is 0.6, as 1 minus 0.4 is 0.6. As mentioned earlier, for our opacity, these distances are inverted. This means the top pixel has an opacity of 0.6, or 60%, and the bottom pixel has an opacity of 0.4, or 40%. Let's update our code accordingly. The distance to the top pixel is just the plotted y-coordinate minus the integer y-coordinate. In other words, it's the fractional part of our plotted y-coordinate. We can use this distance for the alpha values in the putPixel function. For the top pixel, it is 1 minus the distance, and for the bottom pixel, it's simply the distance. And that's all. We now have a pretty good implementation of the algorithm that draws an anti-aliased line. However, we still need to fix some stuff. First of all, the algorithm only works in a single quadrant. Here's a test application I wrote, which draws a line from the center of the screen to my mouse cursor. See, if I move anywhere into the quadrant at the top or bottom, the line is all bugged out. And if I move to the left quadrant, there's no line at all. First, let's fix the left quadrant. The reason it doesn't work is because our algorithm only draws lines from left to right. And in the left quadrant, the line is being drawn right to left. So let's simply swap our start and end points if a line goes from right to left. And now it works. Finally, we need to handle vertical lines. For this, we need to figure out if our line segment is longer on the x or y axis. To do this, we simply check if the absolute change in y is smaller than the absolute change in x. If so, we have a horizontal line and do exactly what we've done before. In the else case, we do exactly the same thing, but swap the purpose of the x and y coordinates. So here we check the y-axis to determine if we flip the points. And the most important difference is that our loop loops through the number of vertical pixels. And of course, we swap the x and y calculations. Finally, we use the horizontal distance and place pixels to the left and right of the plotted points. Makes sense, right? We just adjust everything to work vertically. Now we're almost done. All that's left is dealing with the endpoints. Remember, I said we handled them separately from everything else. Let's draw a short line segment with the algorithm. First, we find the pixels to color in. Then we calculate their opacity based on the vertical distances. Cool. Except something is off. The start and end pixels are fully opaque because we're directly on them. However, that is not quite what we want because the line segment only penetrates about half the pixel. Shouldn't we account for that? If you think not, let me put it this way. There. Now our line segment is barely on the start pixel, but it's still fully opaque. That seems odd, right? If we want a nice and smooth motion, the pixel should clearly be fading out as the starting point moves away from the pixel. To account for this, we're going to calculate how much the line is overlapping the pixel. Let's call that our overlap distance. We then calculate our pixel's opacity the same as before, but multiply it by this overlap distance. This will fade the pixel in as it overlaps more and more with the pixel. But rather than calculating this distance over here, we're just going to take the horizontal distance over here. This is much more simple and it gives us really great results. The same can be done for the last pixel, except here we take the distance to the pixel's left edge. Okay, time to go back to our code and update it. First, we calculate the x overlap distance. And then we calculate the vertical distance just like we did with all the other pixels. Finally, we place our pixels and multiply both distances together to get our final opacity. That's all for the start pixel. Now we do the exact same thing for the end pixel with a slight alteration in the distance calculation. And of course, our loop now only loops through the remaining pixels, excluding the start and end. Of course, we have to do all of this in the else case as well, where we draw vertical lines. There we go. Now our algorithm is done. It's worth noting that we can of course clean this up a little bit. For example, I have a bunch of duplicated expressions. We may want to put those into their own variables. I just didn't do that because I wanted to reduce the number of lines we have, as it's hard to keep all this on the screen nicely. Anyway, our function is now complete. Here's the whole thing. Of course, we could further improve the implementation for both performance or additional features. For example, we could allow lines to have thickness. But that comes with a whole other pile of issues to handle, such as line caps at the endpoints and whatnot. The algorithm can also be used to draw anti-aliased circles. But both of these topics are beyond the scope of this video, so maybe we'll tackle them in another video. Anyway, I hope you learned something and thank you for watching.